The Ukrainian crisis is a culmination of a number of trends which have been brewing in the post-Soviet space. Number one, the Ukrainian crisis is a crisis of transition. Ukraine is now a failed state because its leaders have failed to steer the country away from the collapsed structures of state socialism to some form of viable democratic capitalism, which they regarded as a realistic and desirable goal. The coup d'etat or the revolution, let's call it, you know, every coup can be a revolution if the guys who came power by coup manage to stay in power, all right? Which is, they've been in power since February the 22nd or 23rd. So, well, the more time passes, the more it looks like a revolution. And besides, what started as a nationalist uprising in the capital of Ukraine, in the city of Kyiv, has now spread far and wide to other regions of Ukraine, where Ukrainian nationalism is seen as a mortal threat. And so the revolution is continuing in other forms, just as it did in the Soviet Union in 1991 when the central authority collapsed, just as it happened in the Russian Empire in 1917 when the Tsar abdicated and left utter chaos in the wake. So there is the domestic crisis in Ukraine, and that's the most dangerous thing because that's a big state with 42 million people, and it sits at the intersection of the geopolitical interests of Europe and Russia. And the collapse of the Ukrainian state in the course of this revolution is a threat which is seen as such both in Washington and in Brussels and in Berlin and in Moscow. But there's another reality to the Ukrainian crisis, and that is a competition between Russia and the West for control, for power and influence in Eastern Europe. And Ukraine is regarded as absolutely vital both by the Russians and by the West. Zbigniew Brzezinski has kind of impressed it upon on a whole generation of policymakers in the United States, that this datum, that a Russia without Ukraine is safe because it will never be an empire, but a Russia with Ukraine is by definition an empire. I've never had a chance to debate this with Zbigniew Brzezinski. I know him personally, but I haven't seen him since the Cold War. So, but the thing is that I mean, if we're serious about that, we can have a nice little discussion to test the viability of that proposition. But yet that proposition is now accepted at face value as almost part of New Testament now. So, no, we should never allow Ukraine to fall under the influence of Russia because, you know, then the world order will collapse. And the Russians say, we should never allow Ukraine to become firmly integrated with the West because then, you know, the NATO tanks will be within 5-hour drive from Moscow. And that's absolutely unacceptable for us. Because if it continues to widen as it is now, nobody knows how it will end. You know, in the Cuban Missile Crisis, which was the most dangerous moment in the Cold War, both sides knew what the end game would be. I mean, right from the beginning, they could imagine the terms of the end game, not so in Ukraine, because Ukraine is out of control. In the Obama administration, they may have one scenario as to the end game in Ukraine. In Moscow, they may have another scenario, and they're partly compatible, partly, not entirely, and they're talking about other terms. But try to sell it to the Ukrainians. And that is the most damning part of it all, because there's chaos there. Chaos in the government, chaos in the provinces, chaos in the army. It's a failed state. So a real test of U.S.-Russian relations at this point is whether we are capable of mustering our sense of common interests and address the problems of this very tragic stage in the development of Ukrainian statehood in such a way as to help the Ukrainians sort it out without civil war, without partition, without the country collapsing fully. And when I think about the possibilities, again, I invoke the whole history of the Cold War. And I say, yeah, we've been through crises like this. It's been worse quite a few times. So maybe we'll manage to do it again. And on the big issue, and that has to do with, you know, rise and decline of states, is the perceived decline of the West, which is manifested in the troubles of the European Union, the fiscal crisis in the United States, the weakening of the ability of the West to control world affairs. Is that trend, as well as the trend of Russia increasing its influence in Eurasia, are they incompatible? Or is this perhaps part of a rebalancing that the whole world needs to help the world order to evolve in a more rational and balanced direction so that nobody would feel threatened or insecure, and the possibilities of mutually beneficial cooperation in the global interest would be enhanced? So this is a question. It's not a theoretical question. And again, when I'm in my optimistic mood, I can offer 25 reasons why it is possible. But when I'm in my pessimistic mood, I can just shudder at the implications of where it can go. In the Cold War, we never were sure that we would survive. Some of us thought that we were doomed to die because of the nature of this confrontation. So today, the situation is not that dire as it was in the Cold War, and we're not as divided. The one ideological divide that there is, by the way, and that's a new thing, trip back to the 19th century. Ideologically, Russia today is to the right of the United States. That's why somebody like Pat Buchanan is just in love with Vladimir Putin and his politics. Because it's about family values, you know, limiting gay rights, and so on, nationalism, and so on and so forth. I mean, there is something that's happened. In the 20th century, Russia was simply, in simpler terms, positioned to the left because it was challenging capitalism from the socialist perspective, right? So capitalism on the right. In the 19th century, Russia was on the right. It was an evil empire which was opposed to the ideas of French Revolution, democracy, and so on. Autocrat of Europe could depend on Russia to come to their aid if they were threatened by another revolution. Which is another interesting thing, how history comes back and those pendulum swings are observed. So fundamentally, I think that we should, in times like this, be mindful of the fact that the Russia and the United States have a special relationship in terms of the impact of that relationship on the benefits, on the future of the world and the well-being of the world. And, as part of sanction exchange, the space agencies of Russia and the United States in recent weeks have traded some threats. Some projects have been discontinued, but the International Space Station is still there. So some official in Moscow proposed that, hey, why don't we tell the Americans that we will no longer be allowing them to use our spaceships to take their astronauts to the International Space Station? Because in the absence of the Russian transportation, you can't get there, or you can't return from up there. Immediately, there was an outcry of protest from the Russian space agency. Are you nuts? I mean, the space station depends on close cooperation between the Russians and the Americans, because you know what? It consists of two parts, one Russian, one American. And most of the power sources, are on the American side. So if you isolate the Russian part from the American, the Russians would see the lights dim and the computers kind of begin to malfunction. But guess, take this, the steering engines are on the Russian side. So the Americans, if the Russians declare, you know, an embargo on the Americans, the power, now if both sides go at it, so you have a loss of power, and you have a loss of control of the space station, which means that it may actually fall down. Some of you who have watched Gravity movie know what would be the result. So I think that it's a perfect emblem of the world of our planet, where the two sides cannot afford to go too far up the staircase of confrontation. And there are too many shared interests between the two countries, but more importantly, of the world at large, where these two countries continue to play a special role, for them to be able to weather this particular storm. But then again, you never know. Blunders can be made. Statesmen make mistakes. Countries are drawn into situations where they never thought they would be. especially when you're dealing with a failed state of Ukraine. In the old days, much of the territory of the Ukraine, I'm talking about the Middle Ages, you know how that that part, how that territory was called? The wild field. The place where peace-loving, humble folks would never go, because it's wild. And there are no borders there. And it's just all kinds of desperate men looking for fortune and so on and so forth. So today it's not so much a wild field, but it's really a country in great turmoil. And the challenge is to us all to help them weather the storm.